And today the focus is going to be on motion graphics, motion design, whether you're a designer, an animator, maybe paint style frames. We're going to be taking your questions and be reviewing your work. And joining me today is blind creative director Matthew Encina and blind digital director Ben Burns. Guys, say some words to the good people.
Ben, you want to start?
Yeah, definitely. Hey, everybody. My name is Ben Burns. I'm the digital director here at Blind. I know nothing about motion design, so this is going to be kind of an adventure for me. I'll be kind of the patsy in the room.
Wait, you know something about motion design?
I know who to call.
You know who to call. And sometimes that's more than what you need, right? You just need to know who to call when you're stuck and you need help.
Hey, everyone. I'm Matthew Encina, creative director here at Blind. I've been in the motion industry for about 10 years now, and I've been working here at Blind for about 6+ years, so I've been around the block a couple times.
Matthew, what are some projects you've worked on yourself?
Recently, I've done a lot of work for Xbox and do a lot of work for Microsoft, so that's some fun stuff. 2 years ago, I did an interactive music video for Coldplay, so that was super cool. And a lot of various design and animation projects in between, but those are the ones that come to mind right now.
Great. And if you guys don't know this, Matthew's been on our podcast before, and this is probably a good segue to talk about the podcast. You guys that are tuning in obviously know what channel we're already in, but it turns out a lot of you guys don't know that we have a podcast, and we do totally different content available only on the podcast. And I have to tell you guys that we need your help, we need your support, because we've recently switched the address. It used to be at some other kind of weird address, so we're starting over. So we need you guys to review and to rate and provide comments and feedback for us. And we just dropped a new episode like minutes ago. It's with Trung Bao, and he's a beatbox guy, and he's also a graphic designer, animator, living in Portland now, but originally from Vietnam. Check it out. His story is super inspirational. And I have some big news for you guys too. And if you support us, please support the people who sponsor us. We just picked up a sponsor for the podcast. It's a meal preparation program, subscription delivery service called HelloFresh.com. Go to HelloFresh, you guys, and use the promo code FUTUR, F-U-T-U-R, to save $35 off your first order. I've tried it. It's delicious. It's really well organized, really great ingredients, and I've measured it against other food delivery services, and it's really good. And you guys can customize your meals. There's a lot of flexibility. And there's a nutritionist as well who designs the meals, so they're really well balanced. So what are we doing today, you guys? Those of you guys that are joining me on Crowdcast are going to be able to have a conversation with me. Let me tell you guys how this is going to work. You guys are going to ask a question, which many of you guys have done already, and you're going to vote it up and down. By voting it up and down, I'm going to start there, and I'm going to work my way down the list. And as of right now, I think there are 19 people on, but 45 people registered. That's plenty of people. And I will do my best to answer your questions. And so first, I'm going to, should we get this thing going? Are we all good? Review portfolio, what's the goal, the piece? Okay, that's all good. Yeah, we're ready to go. All right, I'm going to invite you on here. We're going to invite Ben Buchanan. Ben, come on in, dude. Different Ben. Waiting for Ben.
The number of platforms and screens and situations we have going on here is just
out of control,
crazy, right?
It's a little disorienting.
My face is all sorts of different spots, and yeah.
We're going to break the internet.
I hope not.
Come on, Ben, get in here. Ben Buchanan. You're holding up the show, brother. Get on in. And after Ben, I'm going to also invite, let's see here, Josh Jacobs. Is Josh Jacobs in the room? Yeah, he is. All right, Josh, you're going to be next. Make sure you guys have the plugin downloaded and ready to go. Otherwise, you won't be able to join us on the screen. Any minute now, Ben will join us, and then I can do something about it. Ben, are you on screen?
Yeah, it says I've accepted, so.
Okay.
It should be good.
I
don't see myself over there, though.
All right, while we're waiting for Ben to join. Boom. It's a little weird. I'm going to focus this screen. Woo, check that out, guys. Is that pretty awesome? All right, here's his work. This is the work that Ben Buchanan submitted. So let's take a look at this, and here we go. Should I go full screen on this?
Are some of the most beautiful on the planet. We love our beaches. We love the ocean. that's who we are. But each year, millions of tons of litter end up in the sea. And each year, that rubbish kills more than 100,000 marine mammals and over 1 million seabirds. The worst offenders are the filthy five. Food wrappers, bottle caps and lids, polystyrene and foam, plastic bags, and other plastics of unknown origin. The filthy five are ruining our beaches, killing our marine life, and poisoning our seafood. We're doing our bit to keep Aotearoa beautiful. How much do you love your coast?
All right, that was pretty cool. Ben Buchanan, are you on yet? Woo! Close this. Focus this. Accepted and connecting. Both of you guys are accepted and connecting yet. I cannot see you.
Hmm.
This is really weird. Oh, shoot. Okay, you know, Ben, I don't know why you're not coming on right now, but that's okay. Ben, I can see you chatting, so everybody just stay off the channels and let Ben talk to me. Ben, give me a question or give me some information as to what you want me to talk about. I know you just finished MoGraph Mentor and you're just looking for some feedback. Is that all? Mr. Ben? Buchanan? Yeah? Basically, yeah. All right. So, Matthew, you're going to be able to help me out with this crit a little bit, okay?
Yeah. I think for me, like I always ask whenever I review somebody's work, what was the goal of this piece? And then what do you want me to look at specifically? Is it the color and the design? Do you want me to look at the animation? Because there's a whole lot of things that we could look at, and you know, maybe there's certain things that you're personally focusing on that you're trying to accomplish with your work. So I guess before we get into critiquing, I want to know a little bit more about the project and the goal of that project, and then what specifically you'd like us to comment on, because that will be really helpful to keep this laser focused.
Okay, shoot, what is Crowdcast screen sharing? Hide this. Okay, guys, I'm having some technical difficulties here about sharing your screen. What is up? Unfocus the screen. There it is. Okay, so I'm going to play this again. Ben Burns, can you monitor Ben's questions? There's two Bens, so this is probably a bad idea.
Definitely.
Be one. You
call
monitor.
Me Burns.
Okay, Mr. Burns. So I'm going to give you my kind of just unfiltered, straight up feedback, okay? You've recently participated in the MoGraph Mentor Program. Oh, that was weird. I got an echo. All right. I like the design of your piece. It looks really good, and the animation looks good. And I think you've done a really good job. When I look at this, I look at the way that the sun is lit. This is a very graphic piece, right? And it looks good to me. The way that there's some compositing here. Matthew, this reminds me a little bit of the style of the Coldplay video that we worked on. Like, look at that hand there. It's mm-hmm. well illustrated, and I think he animated it really well, picking mm-hmm. up the bits of trash and styrofoam. Like, here's what I'm talking about, the lighting and compositing. This is a concept, you guys, that you're going to need to understand. Like, if you watch and look at photography, it gives you a lot of cues as to how light really works. So when you have a bright light source behind something, it's going to wrap around that thing. So you can see here under his face, the lens flare is wrapping around, and it really marries the images together and makes it look less like a composite but a real thing. It's also nice to break up the graphic quality of this very simple character with a little bit of a lighting effect. So I like that a lot. And the lens flare gets a bad rap from people because they use it improperly. And when I was at Art Center, the industrial designers would throw a lens flare on everything. It really wasn't about selling the composite. It was more about just making it look really shiny. And so a lot of people have that kind of like, oh, instant reaction, it's a lens flare, it's totally cheesy, and it's not. It's just the way light works. When the light source shines inside the lens, you get a flare, and it's kind of nice. Now, let's get critical a little bit here. I mean, I like the warms and cool colors, and I think you did a wonderful job in animating it.
Hang on 1 second, Chris.
Yeah?
We're getting an echo on the audio, so it might be that you have two mics on.
I do have two mics on. Okay, Aaron fixed it.
Okay, great.
Okay, now I can turn back my speaker on, right? Okay.
Good, it's gone now. Got it.
Okay.
Ben said that lighting is the big area that he wants to improve.
So, lighting, okay. All right, that helps. Okay, let's see here. I don't know. I think this looks really good. Okay, let's talk about a couple of concepts here, you guys. We know that from studying photography and illustration, there's something called atmospheric perspective. Things that are farther away from the camera get lighter in terms of its saturation. It's because there's more air particles between our eyes and the thing that we see. So generally speaking, the things closer to camera are more vivid and have more saturation, and the things that are farther away from camera are kind of lighter in its color and its saturation. So we got that going. We got these dark plants and the flowers in the foreground framing the shot, which I like. It draws our eyes in, and if you look at the two flowers that are blossoming or whatever, they're pointing towards the center, and I like that. It's kind of a very symmetrical composition, but that's a good thing. I like that there are some birds placed in the scene themselves, and it's like five birds. If anything, what I would say is for the composition is to have maybe one bird a little bit closer to the foreground to really kind of create depth and illusion. Matthew has a great video on that and an article on how to create depth. So make the small things in the background a little bit smaller, make the mid-ground things a little bit bigger, and it's gonna seem like they're a lot farther apart from each other. And right now, there's really nothing for the sun to wrap around. If there's anything in terms of compositing and lighting, you could add a few God rays across the stem of the flower and just kind of really marry those two plates together. But I think where it comes into play is here. You've done a good job here, so it sells the composite and the look. Okay, let's look at this scene here. I think this is probably where it gets a little bit weaker. When it's falling through the earth, I don't know how else to design it, but the same kind of level of thinking and I don't know, the amount of polish put into it, it's a little bit light here. It just falls for a long time and it hits the water. Mm-hmm. Here you have God rays or light rays filtering through the scene, and that looks good to me. If anything, your bottled water might be a little hot in exposure in the scene itself. I wouldn't mind having a little bit of the elements in the foreground sharper or something else, because the focal plane seems super shallow here, and maybe that would be a little bit nicer. That's my take on that. What about you, Matthew?
Yeah, I think for me, overall, I think the colors are really nice. It has this illustrative style there, which allows for you to take some liberties as far as lighting goes. But I think to make things pop out, you want to control the contrast. So I think you actually do a good job here, even though that the bottle looks hot, according to Chris, I feel like my eye is going directly to that thing. Whereas the other scenes when we're above ground and on the sand, where we have the guy walking around and even the shot before, I feel like the contrast is a little bit even across the board. So I don't really know where my eye is going. So if I look at the opening scene, I see that we have these two long plants, and that's where my eye is going. It's not necessarily directed at anything. But if there was something at the center that you want me to focus on, that's probably where I would focus the contrast on.
Maybe like a little vignette?
Maybe a little vignette, right? Like, or the foreground stuff is just a little bit darker. The angles of the two branches there, if they're pointing a little bit more towards something, then it would be a little bit clearer as to what my eye should be directed towards. But I know that there's a lead in here. There's some narration that's going on. So maybe it's not super important that we are focusing on anything in particular. This part, I think, is a lot clearer, just visually, just being able to track the story of this particular water bottle and then all the other elements around it. I do agree with Chris that you could probably play with the depth of field a little bit more in here and some of the values, because if you look at the stuff way in the back and then the stuff in the foreground, everything's about the same light value. I think you could push those where the stuff in the foreground's a little bit darker, the stuff in the background's more washed out, and so that you could really focus on that center point in the middle and give that scene a lot of depth.
Yeah, if anything here from a narrative point of view, and I know you're not asking us to do this, but I'm going to talk about it anyways, which is to have maybe a fish kind of peck away at the pieces of foam, because mm-hmm. that's kind of a crazy idea, right? Mm-hmm. So that'll give meaning for the next shot here, where the bird has actually eaten a lot of the plastics and he's perished from eating that. So just putting that as part of the story might be really good. And I think you could use a little secondary animation here, and I know I'm adding all sorts of crazy stuff to your list of things to do and think about, but it'd be cool if the bottle actually had a label on it and the label was somewhat kind of broken or deteriorated, You know how when the labels around bottles get loose, so you can actually add another animation piece into it. Right. If this is an animation reel, I look for those kind of little details and the illusion of life, and those kind of things add a lot. Mm-hmm. So here, not much is happening. There's some bubbles, and then the fish kind of dancing. They kind of swim into the scene, but they're not really doing a whole lot.
Right. Okay? I think the whole idea is that all this plastic in the water is creating danger for all the sea life there. And I think in the previous scene, if we're looking at it, you know, those two fish in there don't really feel like they're in a whole lot of danger. So those are little things that you could emphasize just to make it feel a little bit more treacherous for them.
Yeah, if they were eating like little pieces of plastic, I think that, or trash. Mm-hmm. That kind of makes me think about how it enters into our food system.
That's right.
Right? So here, you know, these parts, I know you're trying to just really quickly go through all the different kinds of trash, but they don't seem to have the same kind of rendering or quality that the other shots have. And so I try and look for consistency across your shots. I want to see how they all tie together, okay? The hand I like a lot, and the hand adds a lot. Some secondary animation there. Good camera move on the back end here where you're pulling, you're dollying or tracking back and you're booming up a little bit. I like that, okay? Now, this is the worst part of your animation, and I know you don't care about this part, the business end of things, but this looks like it comes from a whole other world, another universe. The Sustainable Coastlines logo and the three dolphins kind of swimming like that, and these weird caustic effects, they just don't feel consistent with the visual language that you've established. Everything else is kind of very graphic and flat, and this is some other thing. So I would say, if anything, make this simpler or put more love into it, because it's kind of living in no man's land. I want to see a strong piece from beginning to end. And I hope that helps. All right, we're going to go back into this, our call here.
We're getting rave reviews from the folks on YouTube, including MoGraph Mentor, who's joining us.
Oh, what up? Michael? Michael Jones, right?
Yep, he said you're the best. I don't know about that. But
okay, oh, here's Ben. Look, Ben. Can you hear me, Ben?
Yeah.
Not you.
No, that's me.
Oh.
Wrong Ben. This is Burns. You should have signed in as Burns.
Burns, I'm going to hide your screen. Whatever. All right. Okay, I'm going to remove Ben Buchanan, and let's go on to the next person. Let's see here. Josh, I'm going to invite you on, and let's see if we can get this to work. Josh Jacobs. Let's see who's going to be next. I want to give you guys a heads up. David. You're going to be next, okay, David?
Yo.
All right. Dude, look at that. David is on. Let me turn on your
mic. On point.
Dude, there look at that. Go. I don't hear you, David, because my speaker is turned on. Okay, David, say something. Not David, I'm sorry. Josh. Josh, say something.
The audio is good?
Audio is great. Sorry, guys. This is like three monkeys trying to balance and juggle five balls. And I'm not saying who's a monkey here, but okay. So give me a little bit of context while we look at your work, okay? Let me fire up your piece.
So this was a final project for my design class about a year ago, year and a half ago.
Yeah.
And my instructor was getting us introduced into Adobe After Effects, and as a way to help us understand the program, he introduced us to a method called kinetic typography.
Yeah, yeah.
I already knew it existed. This is 2015, but I was really interested in this style of animation around 2013. So I had some opportunity to dabble with it with like Apple Motion. I don't know if people still use that program, but I'm more immersed into the Adobe Creative Cloud system as of now. So once I got into this assignment, I kind of had an idea of how I can organize all of my clips and pre-compose and stuff to make a massive project. So I decided to go all out and animate a music video. I made my own music video. It's Look at Me Now by Chris Brown and Busta Rhymes, like the really fast-paced rapping. I thought it'd be a really cool challenge. And if you guys
okay, I'm gonna play it now. Okay, I'm gonna play it right now.
Sure. I can tell you now, Chris, that that the frame rate from the screen cap isn't that good. So if you just want to watch it, you guys can click the link in the poll.
Yeah, yeah.
So you can look at it full.
Maybe Ben, you can share that link on our different feeds. Yeah. So the people who can't see the Crowdcast screen
Good, I actually have your live stream. I'll just drop it in.
Okay, drop it in. Drop it in right now, you guys. The internet's going to help us. This is going to be awesome. I'm going to play this, and so everybody, let's check it out.
Yeah, Facebook has it.
Hey, let's go! Cause I'm feeling like I'm running and I'm feeling like I gotta get away, better know that I don't and I won't ever stop, cause you know I gotta win every day, day. She didn't really, really wanna pop me, just know that you will never flop me, and I know that I gotta be a little cocky. You ain't never gonna stop me. Every time I come, a nigga gotta set it, then I gotta go, and then I gotta get it, then I gotta blow, and then I gotta shut it. Any little thing a nigga think that he be doing, cause it doesn't matter, cause I'm gonna dead it, dead it, then I'm gonna murder everything and anything about a boom, about a bing. I gotta do a lot of things to make it clear to a couple niggas that I always win, and then I gotta get it again and again and again. And I be doing it to death, and now I move a little foul. Nigga better call a ref, and everybody know my style. A nigga know that I'm the best when it come to doing this. And I be banging on my chest, and I'm banging in the east, and I'm banging in the west. And I come to give you more, and I would never give you less. You will hear it in the street, and you can read it in the press. Do you really wanna know what's next? Let's go.
That was a really long outro. All right. Good job, man. Good job. All right. Let's switch back to this. Unfocus that screen. Boom. All right. I'll focus on you. All right. So you can see. Yeah, we can see you now, right? Move your hand or something, dude. It's a little stuck. You guys see it stuck on your end?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On your end, too?
That's all right. I mean, if we could hear him, it's all good.
All right. We only need to hear you. It's cool. You're frozen in time. You're doing the robot or something like that. Okay, that was a tricky song to do because Busta Rhymes is speaking like 100 miles an hour. Okay, so how best can I provide feedback to you so you can move forward in your life and your career? What do you want to hear from us?
Do you feel, and I've run this video past a couple of people and they certainly enjoy it. And because I have an honest bias and most creators have bias towards the work that they put out into the world. In your opinion, do you think there's anything about the video that's kind of awkward or doesn't really fit as well as the other parts? I noticed you made a comment on the outro. It was kind of long. I'm looking for like really nitpicky criticism. That's what I'm looking for.
Then you are talking to the right two people. Matthew, get your knives out. You're probably more scalpel. I'm probably more butcher knife. Okay. So Matthew, I'll go first, and then you get ready to go. Okay.
Go ahead.
Josh, you ready?
Yeah, let's go.
All right, let's go. First thing is, I think you went a little bit crazy on the motion blur. I like motion blur for certain things, but this is just too much motion blur. When you're doing a more graphic animated piece with typography, and the kinetic typography assignment is always good. It's basically making a lyric video, and there's a couple things you need to do. One is you need to do service to the song and the lyrics, and I think you got that because it's rapid fire. And then the other part is to show off a little bit of your design skills. So here, I think what you're doing is you're going against type, right? It's a rap song, and he's going super fast, but you've got this serif italic face, which is throwing me off a little bit, but I think that's a good thing to try, to go against type. Instead of doing two bold sans serif typefaces, you're mixing a sans serif and a serif together. And I think that's kind of nice. I would have preferred it if it were a little bit more graphic and punchy in terms of the animation, like it's harder hitting. It feels a little soft. And part of that is because the motion blur is so heavy, okay? And I think you could do things where instead of just setting a keyframe from the beginning of the rotation, I'm sorry, I should be sharing that screen. Let me try that again. Okay, so I'm scrubbing through your animation right now. So I'm seeing your type come on. And something that I've learned by watching people who are really good at animation, they really know how to play around with the animation curves. And I think that's where I see room for improvement from you. Is to really get things to build anticipation and then overshoot, you know, anticipation and overshoot concepts, and maybe employ a little bit more squash and stretch. So when the words say pop, they really kind of feel like they're being inflated and they pop. Okay. Another thing I'd like for you to think about in the future, maybe not so much for this piece, but try it on something else. Like, well, you can overwork a piece to death. I just say this is a kind of a stamp in time and a reflection of what you know at that time. Make another piece and just keep growing. The other thing I want to see is Z-depth. I want to see things exist on more than one plane.
Yeah.
Right? I think everything lives on one plane right now.
if you keep scrolling,
what was the term you used?
There's a section where I have a bunch of. If you scroll forward, in the hail part.
Right here.
Yes, right there.
Okay. It's very subtle.
Probably
okay.
Not enough, right?
All right. Perfect. So everybody knows what I'm talking about. I want to see things exist on more than one plane. Plane, right? And what we're going to do is create depth. Like they exist in space, and each card of type is 10 feet away from the next. So what he's done here, let me play this little part. I'll turn the audio off so we can hear each other. Okay, so you have a little bit of move, and what I want to see is a more exaggerated move. Like it drifts and then it snaps back, and it drifts and it snaps back, and we can see the camera travel a greater distance. It's very subtle. One could mistakenly see these as little scales and a position change, right? So you want to be very clear and deliberate. I think a lot of what we talk about and do in design and animation is to be very, to have intent, right? Like this is my intent, it's very, very, very clear. It's nobody's gonna be confused by that. You do one big camera move back here when you pull them all away. Oops, it goes so fast. There's your big camera move. But you see how it lands, and as it's landing, you're already kind of sliding the animation out. And that softens the impact of the type landing. Okay, so let me play that part. It says what? Inhale. So inhale should land hard, one beat, and then slide out. And before it slides out, you might do a little anticipation and draw it to the right and then shoot. So those are little things that we look for. And the people who are really good at this, they seem to have mastered the concept of anticipation and overshoot and adjusting the curves. So things move really slow and then they move fast and they slow down at the end. Right? That's me with my butcher knife. Matthew, you have anything to add to that?
You covered a lot of the big ones. I think the other things, back to your original question about what is standing out in an awkward way, I think the about two-thirds of the way in when there's illustrations of the newsstand and stuff like that, or even this illustration of the dice, like those are the moments that kind of threw me off just a little bit because they felt like they didn't gel with the style of the typography. That's a nitpicky thing. The other thing that that Chris didn't touch on but I think would be really fun actually is right now everything is just happening on this vignetted white background, but there are never any moments where the values flip, where everything inverts. So there could have been a great moment where if you started with, what's his name, Chris Brown rapping and it's black on white, what could be cool is by the time it gets to Busta Rhymes, it could flip and then now it's white type on black, right? So those could be really cool moments where you're trying to flip who's speaking at what point, or if there's a change in the lyric or the meaning of the song, you could use that moment to invert the values there and just have a little bit more fun.
That's an interesting idea.
Okay, I'm gonna say one more thing and then we're gonna move on to the next caller here. The other thing I wanted you to do is just maybe brush up a little bit more on your typography. I could see this animation looking 10 times better if this typeset was a little bit more sophisticated, like using bold and light weights next to each other and varying your point sizes on the screen. Right now everything's one point size, one weight, and all centered up. And you know me, it's like I'm really picky about my typography. The other thing too is maybe the references that you use for, say, this street thing here. I feel like this could be a little bit illustrated a little bit better. And I think what do I mean by that? I mean, the pole itself maybe has a rounder top, so it doesn't look like a stick. So you create the illusion of space and depth. And maybe the center pole is thicker, and the sign, the weight around the sign is a little bit thinner, so more contrast. Because everything looks like it's one weight, and it doesn't have a great sense of depth and design there, okay? Like even the buildings in the back. Okay, hold on. Even the buildings in the back, maybe there's the shapes themselves could be designed a little bit better. And it's easy to go on Pinterest and look for like really inspirational work. You don't need to invent all this stuff. Look at what you like and then try to replicate it. Go ahead. Go with your question.
Do you feel my type combination is good? I'm using a really like luxurious sans serif, and that's Avenir, I believe. I'm using a very luxurious serif and an Avenir for my sans serif. Do you think those work together?
Yeah, I do. I mean, it's hard to combine typefaces. It really is. And so better compared to what? And another designer would come in and then change the font and the typeset, and it would be like amazing. absent a reference point, I think you're doing an okay job with it. And it is very difficult. If you're not a typographic wizard, I would just caution you, if you guys have not seen it, I have a typography manual, just to read it and use those rules. It'll help you out a lot. You don't necessarily need to take a full-on typography course to get better at design, but just upping your game in typography and design would really help out your animations, okay?
All right,
dude. Thanks for joining us. I'm going to bounce you off and bring on David. Should we take a moment now to pause and while we're bringing on David? David, I'll invite you on screen, David.
Next time you play a video, would you mind going full screen? It's a little small for the peeps.
Yeah, I was afraid that it might break it. Where's David? David's not here. All right. So David is in a different time zone. I think David's on Australia or something like that, right? Well, since his thing got two votes, let's I'll read his question for the group, and then we'll go from there, okay? And you guys are monitoring questions. Nobody's got any questions? You guys make sure if you have a question to type it in, and then Matthew and Ben and everybody else will kind of do our best to kind of pick up the very best questions that addresses the broadest group of people. So here's the question from David. Any tips on getting experience when very few places offer motion experience? A newish industry, few producers, procedures and placements. Seems the way to go is take on other work to pay your bills while you keep improving your work until they can't ignore you. Your thoughts. So I just read the question. I'm going to throw it to Matthew first. So Matthew, any tips on getting experience when the places where he's working are far and few between and they just don't know what they're doing?
Yeah, I feel like you just have to do it yourself. I think I'm just going back to my own experiences. Luckily, the industry was pretty flourishing here when I was going to school. But even in school, I felt like I was lacking the opportunities to make the type of work that I wanted to based off of the curriculum I was given. So I felt a little boxed in. So what I ended up doing is I just hacked my education and ended up creating the assignments that I wanted and just kind of did that on my own time and created my own thing. So I think if you're lacking opportunities there in where you currently live, David, I would just invent the opportunities yourself. There's so many people online on Instagram. I'm in a couple of Facebook groups where people are just creating stuff for fun. And people are making amazing work that they could never make for a client right out of school or as one of their first opportunities. So I think just do it yourself, and that'll serve you way, way better than trying to find the opportunity somewhere else.
Very well. That was a good answer. Look, we live in a pretty privileged world here, you guys, in that we're in Santa Monica, and within a 3-mile radius or so, there are 30 design motion design companies. We're in the kind of triangulation of three really great design and animation schools in terms of Art Center, Otis, and Cal Arts. And so there's a hotbed of motion design activity. And if you're in some place where these opportunities don't exist, you're going to have to create your own. Thankfully, there are many resources available online. Michael Jones is in the group here. I think he's paying attention to this. He does MoGraph Mentor, and they have a very interesting program. And Joey runs the School of Motion. And then there's Ash Thorpe with, what's this thing called?
Learn Squared. Yeah.
And there's a lot of these kind of things. You can learn from the very best people and the best practitioners in the world and just tune in for a fraction of the cost. And if that's not for you and you have access and you want to have lots of teachers, go to one of the private art schools. Opportunities there. Look, you can't really change your circumstance. If these things are happening to you, you just got to figure your way out and invent your own solution. And I was fortunate enough to sit in on Joey's demo on animation, and I'm taking the course myself. It gets deep, and it's like stuff I wish I knew when I was going to school. So the resources are there, and you can learn lots of great things. And once you see a couple like demo reels, and you're like, okay, dude, that should be my goal, and I'm going to make a demo reel that's going to be as good as that reel, you're going to get work, and you're going to move yourself into whatever market you want to be in, okay? Generally speaking, though, I think animators need to be in the towns or cities where the work is being produced. So you may work on your reel, get into a place where people are going to give you opportunities to work, and then eventually migrate to where those places are. There's a reason why there are so many actors, writers, behind the camera people, all this kind of in Los Angeles, because the opportunities are here, okay? All right, let's
move on.
We
got a couple of questions on YouTube.
Okay,
if you want to take
couple of questions on YouTube. Ben, hold on. Give me 1 second. I'm going to
bring
you up on the screen. Turn your camera on and turn your mic on. Cheryl, you want to tell us something?
Oh, I think we're going to have a feedback loop.
Yes.
As long as we're cutting Tim on camera, we're good.
Oh, cut Tim on camera, so I turn off his mic?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Colm O'Neill wants to know about tools. What tools do we use to do this?
The old tools question. All right, Aaron, bring the camera on me. Zoom in on me.
I'm curious because I don't know what you guys use to create this stuff anyway.
All right, so, Ben.
Rookie here. Let's go.
You're like going to temper my anger, right? Like, ooh, ah! Okay, guys, I'm going to give you the answer and then I'm going to yell at you. Here's the answer. We use Adobe Creative Suite. Basically, it's Illustrator and Photoshop. That's the bedstone of all of what we do here. We use After Effects for a lot of the 2D and hybrid 2.5D animation. 2.5D suggests characters that exist on a multiplane and moving the camera around. It's not quite real 3D, but you can now bring in 3D elements too within Photoshop and After Effects now. And you can also use a program like Cinema 4D. Cinema 4D allows you to build real 3D things, and there's some great integration between Cinema 4D and After Effects. That's your suite, and you do your compositing, your color correction inside After Effects. Some people like to use some plugins, and some plugins might be, if you can afford it, the GenArts suite of plugins. Mm-hmm. They're awesome, and Matthew's talked about those plugins before. What other plugins do you use?
GenArts, Sapphire. Magic Bullet
for color correction?
Color correction.
So presets, if you don't want to deal with all the settings, just use Magic Bullet and then tweak them a little bit.
And there's a bunch of other
Film
little
Convert
ones.
Is another one.
Mm-hmm, for
What about the Trapcode guys? The Trapcode guys make some excellent 3D plugins.
Staples, those are all staples.
3D Stroke. What are the other plugins they use?
Lux, Starglow, the old ones.
Starglow.
Particular, the mother of all plugins.
Beautiful stuff. And Now that we've gone over the tools, I have to say, to stop talking about the tools. The tools don't make you. I've seen people do incredible animations with their iPhone. It doesn't really matter. People think that there's a tool, a magic bullet that you can just use. Just like in marketing, people think there's just this one thing that's holding them back. If I only had that program, if I only had that, it doesn't matter. It may be less efficient. It may take you more time to do it without the special plugins, but you can totally do everything without the plugins themselves. And actually, I think it's a good thing, and I'll tell you why, okay? I use, basically, Photoshop 1.0 up until now. I know, I am old, okay? I use Photoshop 1.0 before they had, like, multiple levels of undo. You had one undo. I used it when there was one layer, and so then I had to use the tools and master the 6 or 7 tools you can use. And those are still the bedrock foundation of what I use today. And I'm still, in a way, schooling the young kids because they're like, how'd you do that? I'm like, dude, this is the way we did it. This is the only way we do it. And there's the tools become a crutch. They become a thing that you don't understand the principles of what it is you're doing. And then you forget. And without that plugin, you're like worthless. I remember, I'm going to tell you guys a story here. And it's gonna mess up your mind a little bit. I had a young illustrator here. I asked her to do something. And she's like, I can't do it, Chris. And I, what do you mean? And she's like, I need you to buy this plugin. And I just rolled my eyes. Are you kidding me? I hired you, I'm paying you your day rate. And now you're telling me you need this, you need that. You're so needy. And you know what I need to do? I need to find another designer. That's what I need to do. Okay, and rant, let's keep going. Ben, you got another question before I freak out?
Yeah, definitely.
All right, throw another good one at me, dude.
Totally different. Right. How can motion design improve a logo?
How can a motion designer improve a logo?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, are you setting me up for another rant?
Yeah.
All right. Is the camera on me? How can a motion designer improve a logo?
Excuse me, a logo presentation. This comes from Mr.
Oh, you love it. That's the entire nature of my answer. You got to read the rest of the sentence, dude.
It's a little different. How can I use motion graphics to improve a logo presentation? That's by Mr.
Okay.
Cote.
All right. Cote. Woo! You talked me off the ledge there. I was going to explode like TNT, man. All right. How can motion graphics improve a logo presentation? That went from a horrible question to a really, really good question. All right. In our line of work, we have to work with logos that are given to us by clients and brands. It is foolish for us to think we should go and change it and to judge it. The only thing you need to do is to try to figure out what the best qualities of the logos are and try to think of a little story that you can tell, okay? I remember a long time ago when there was a dot-com boom, we were working on an account. It was called babystyle.com, babystyle.com. It doesn't exist. Don't even try to internet. Look it up, okay? Babystyle.com had a little symbol, and it looked like an ampersand, okay? And the symbol itself, I looked at it, and I kept staring at it, and in the counter of the logo, the negative space for you tech people, or your type people, the counter looked like an embryo. And all the designers are doing boards, and I looked at them like, oh, that's why they designed the logo like that. That's not an arbitrary shape. That's actually trying to tell a little bit of a story. Baby style, there's a little embryo, you know, like in the womb. And I said, you guys, what we need to do is to remove the entire logo, have a little animation around that embryo, and make it look like it's a little heart is beating and it moves a little bit. And then we reveal the rest of the logo. And I presented that to the director, his name's Scott Burns, and he's like, genius, I love this. You know what, that idea is so good, I wish I came up with that. And that's what motion graphics can do for a logo. That's one application. I'm gonna tell you the second application and what you can do with an animated logo. If you look up Michael Beirut, okay, he uses motion design to present his work to his clients. Because look, truth be told, these large corporate multi-billion dollar multinational brands have very simple logos. And so when you're asked to rebrand and redesign the logo, oftentimes the execution looks like using a classic font like Helvetica, Futura, something like Gotham or DIN, one of those beautiful typefaces. And in order to get around his clients pushing back and saying, well, you just type that in, which is kind of deceptive because that's not what happens. What he does is he animates and presents the work as an evolution of ideas by using animation. And he likes to think about the marks and symbols as little stories that move around. So when he was doing a presentation, you guys can look it up. I think he was doing it at Google or maybe at MIT, I don't remember, but it was for the MIT labs. And he was showing how a system of little black squares meant something. And he uses animators to do that. So those are two really great ways of using motion design and integrating with logos, okay? So that's also given me a tip. When I look at Michael Beirut present a $500,000 logo assignment, how can a guy like him justify that kind of cost? Well, first of all, he has an impeccable portfolio and I'm sure like a ton of client testimonials, but he's also thinking about how to tell the story with motion because it adds a lot of wow and pizzazz. He's not the only one. I've seen other people, I forget if they're called what their company's called, I think maybe Futur Brand or something like that. Something like that, where they did a presentation, I watched them, and they animate their presentation as well. So that's a good opportunity for you if you're a motion designer to go work for one of the large branding firms who knows how to use motion in the art of storytelling. I think that's it for that. Let's move on.
YouTube is really upset that you're using Photoshop with one undo.
That's the way it worked, man. That's the way it worked. And YouTube needs to know, you guys need to know this, YouTube. You know, we worked with files that had to be saved on a 99 megabyte hard drive called a zip disk. 99 megabyte file, that was your limitation, because then you'd have to split the file. And you don't want to get into splitting files. So while you guys wrap your head around that, I want to take a quick break in case you guys are joining us. What the heck are we doing here? We are doing live broadcasting to all the different platforms. I'm Chris, I'm joined by Matthew Encina, our creative director, and Mr. Ben Burns, the real Ben Burns, and he's our digital director. And we're here just to answer your questions. And in this edition, we're gonna focus on motion graphics, motion design, okay? We haven't seen anybody submit work for style frames yet, so let's see if something comes up. All right, so Veniel, you're on screen. Here we go, we're gonna bring up. Hey, can you hear me, caller? Veniel, say something. Veniel Ian Coronado. Going once. Veniel, you're on screen, brother. You gotta say something. All right, well, while he figures out his microphone situation, let's see what he has to say. Okay, he has a piece of work, great. So I'll ask his question since he can't speak right now. I cannot hear you. Do a mic check, dude. Okay, here it goes. I don't know how to say your name. I'm gonna pretend like it's Veniel. And he says, Chris. Okay, thank you. So inspired. He wonders if his work is ready for the business world. And he wants to know, what are the signs you're ready to start your own business? Okay. Let me see. I resigned to my work to start freelancing. Okay, so he quit his job, and now he's freelancing. He's thinking about starting his own business. Okay, so let's unfocus his screen, focus this screen, and we're gonna try to play his work and go full screen on it. Okay, it's already pretty big. Can we go bigger, Ben? Big Ben. See how I did that, Ben? All right, here we go. Woe is right. Woe is right. Okay. Ooh, sorry, I didn't mean to do that, guys. Let me see if I can scrub around here. Turn off the audio here.
Okay, was that a unicorn there?
No, or I wish it were. Horses? I think they're just horses. I shouldn't say just. There's a couple of them, you know. Let's see. The resolution is a little choppy here, so I didn't see a unicorn. Nope. Okay. So this feels to me like the roll up on the Paramount logo with mm-hmm. the stars kind of hover over the lake. Mm-hmm. And that's a really beautiful animation with crazy lighting, right? And mm-hmm. reflections on the water. Okay. So this is where it gets a little crazy. So let's park it right around here. All right. Where do we begin here? I am assuming you're a 3D animator and you're just starting out in the world and you're trying to figure out what you're going to do. It's obvious to me you have some skills, but there's a pretty big gap from where you're at and where I put like the Paramount logo. If you guys don't know what the Paramount logo I'm talking about, is it Paramount or Universal?
No, it's Paramount.
It's Paramount. Yeah. There's a mountain kind of like this. Stars fly over the lake kind of like this. And then the stars land in a very elegant way around the peaks of the mountain. And it's the Paramount logo. And it's awesome. And it's done during golden hour. Why do I bring that up? Because inevitably people compare your work. And you just need to be aware. You know my point of view on originality. There's no such thing. So all you need to do is do something that is as good as the thing that you're referencing. And if you're referencing that, great. If you're not, you need to be more aware of what you're looking at or work that's come before you, okay? What can we do to improve this quickly? We can just change the time of day. Put this more at golden hour. There's a reason why they did it at golden hour, because everything looks better when it's around dusk, right? Right before the sun goes down. Do something like that. You can use a little bit more of compositing magic here, because mm-hmm. it looks straight up cold CG to me. What can we do? You can add some highlights and glints on the edges of the metal to make it really sparkle and shine. And I would suggest too that you do some multi-pass rendering and really do some comp love, hashtag comp love, all right? You need to do that, because that's usually what happens to CG shots. I've seen incredible things happen when you have a really kind of basic base plate, and they comp in like little atmospheric things, mist, birds. They comp in lots of things in 2D with an exported 3D camera. If you want to go next level, I think you have to do that. You have to do some color correction in the sky to bring it down. And I'm not even getting into the CG work itself, because it does kind of look a little bit like high-end video game work. And that's not good or bad, or saying if you're not trying to do video game work, then you need to change that, okay? I'm not sure if you're using a terrain generator like what is called Vue, V-U-E, mm-hmm. which you can build worlds like this, but the things I've seen people do with Vue look photoreal. So here's a question you have to ask yourself. Am I interested in making photoreal work or highly stylized like motion graphics work. Remember, we were talking about having intent, being very clear, being very intentional. I don't know if you're trying to do photoreal work, because this is not photoreal work to me. And this does not look like stylized 2D work either, so you're kind of stuck in this no man's land. Matthew, you want to add something to that?
I think you covered a lot of the bases, but I kind of want to get towards the end, the transition.
Oh, you're going to go for the easy kill.
To the logo at the end. Because okay. I thought actually the camera moves are really nice.
It was a good move.
The camera moves feel like these nice sweeping moves. It feels grand. It feels really big. I agree with you on all the other things about lighting and compositing. You could do so much more, even just with this render, to make it look so much more amazing. I think this would benefit by having a couple more things fly around by camera. Like, I think the best moment is like when the type is kind of flying by, or we're flying by that tree that passes by in the mid-ground halfway through. So I think having more dynamic moments like that, where things are passing by or very close to camera, feel good. But the part that I want to talk about is the very end, the transition to the end. Because this whole thing, I was thinking it's going to be this nature-oriented thing, and then we transition to the logo with these very geometric, technical triangle shapes with dots. And I don't know why we do that. And I didn't even know that this whole thing was supposed to be about food. So that was the thing that kind of threw me off. Like, I felt like we were leading to this grand reveal of something, and then the payoff threw me off. I didn't know how I should have interpreted the past 10 seconds that I just watched.
Yeah. Well, you know what? This is a perfect tie-in to the previous question about what you can do with motion graphics to help logos. All right. Mount David Foods Corporation. I'm going to assume this is a real logo. And if you designed it, I'm going to insult you right now, because it's a horrible logo. It's not legible. It's using like too many tricks. There's gradients in the mountains, and there's this crazy rainbow mohawk thing that's going on. Everything about this is throwing me off, okay? So this is like one of those situations where if you inherit a really crummy logo, what are you gonna do? So he tried to make the best of the situation. I'm gonna give him kind of an A for effort, because if you look at the previous animation, it was like, hey, it's pretty cool. And then you land on this, like, oh my God. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of a cognitive dissonance, and everybody's like, what? So they have to feel like they come from something. So this is where I think you would do yourself a favor if you went and looked online or watched a bunch of movies and looked at all the production studio logos, because they do a really good job. Like, you know the Bad Robot logo for J.J. Abrams' company? That is not a good logo. The little red robot is like, Bad Robot! He comes in, you know? And when you see the TV version of the logo, it's like a robot and it's just kind of illustrated. It's a little CG.
It's a little flat.
It's a little flat, and it's like kind of a fake plot of grass, and like the vignetting is out of control, and that would like end every episode of Lost. Bad Robot. And then you see the theatrical version, and it didn't start out this way, but then it got like more real and more cinematic. And there's a lot of like logos that are really simple, like New Line Cinema. New Line Cinema is a great example. Very simple logo. And it's like a strip of film, and then the strip of film is cut in a certain way, so it looks like an N. But the way that they did that was they had huge pieces of film falling from behind camera, and there's God rays, and then it just lands, and it's really beautiful. Mm-hmm. And this is like the art of doing a logo reveal, to look at the forms. So here, we're never going to get away with these kind of like really crude brush strokes that represent the mountains. So here's an example of how you can do this. Let's say you start really close and you see a brushstroke draw on, but maybe as it's drawing on, the colors fill in like it's watercolor. And you're following the brushstrokes against this kind of majestic trail, so you think it's some enormous thing. And as it keeps drawing on, you cut to different parts, and then it lands and resolves on the mountain, and then the rainbow spreads open and the type reveals itself. So you're going to make the logo the hero, not the animation preceding it. There's a big difference between those two things. It's almost like you're making the logo look worse by doing too good of a job with your animation ahead of it, whereas you're supposed to treat it with respect, okay? I don't know if that was helpful to anybody. I'm starting to get tired, you guys. All right, I'm going to close this. All right, boom. Close this. Minimize. All right, buddy. I'm sorry I could not hear you, Veniel. Ian Coronado. I hope that was helpful, and I'm going to close you out.
He says thank you.
Okay, you're welcome, buddy. And I'm gonna focus on my face. All right. Whew, this is hard. All right, Josh, we took care of. We took care of Veniel. Does somebody else want to ask another question? This is probably a good time to turn back to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube to see what other kind of questions you guys
have.
Any
questions on Facebook there?
Any questions? I'm going to drink my tea instead. And this is not a sponsor, by the way.
We had a pretty in-depth discussion on design education platforms or places where you can go.
Man, you don't pull me in, brother.
Places where they can go to start learning about design, like fundamentals and things like that. I recommended starting at Skillshare and kind of dabbling around there. Of course,
our design or animation?
A design.
Design. Okay. There are very few, thankfully, good resources to learn design. Some are free, some cost money, and so you have to think about what's right for you and what fits your budget and your timeline. Some people are young and they have a lot of time, so you can dig around the internet. And if you're, say, a career switcher, you might want to just pay some money and get this thing done with so you can get the skills that you need. And so they all vary in price, but they're all relatively affordable, okay? At the very top of the hill, no pun intended here, is something like Art Center, and it's going to cost you somewhere between like $20,000 in tuition. And all the schools are priced very similarly in this area. So CalArts, Otis, and if there are Otis or CalArts people watching, you're like, no, it's not that amount, then let us know. It's been some time since I paid tuition. And just to date myself here, when I started Art Center, tuition was, wait for it, $3,500. $3,500. Okay, a few short years later, two decades, it is now over $20,000. And back then, I was sweating, Ben. $3,500, I'm like, how am I gonna make this happen? Now, when I say that, people are like falling out of their chair. But that's the reaction I had when I was at Art Center, and they were like, oh, it used to be $2,000. I'm like, $2,000? Something has happened here, I don't know. So you start at the top of the hill and you go all the way down, there's free resources. If you're looking to just gain technical skills, Skillshare, lynda.com, Udemy.
Mm-hmm. Our channel.
There's this stupid channel called thefutur.com. You guys can check those people out. I don't know if they know what they're doing. Who else?
I mean, there's General Assembly, but that's in person at various
General centers. Assembly, good one, Matthew. That's kind of moving up there a little bit. Mm-hmm. Like we already said, Learn Squared, a MoGraph Mentor, a School of Motion. Those are all really good resources. And we set up, originally we set up to kind of create this channel to teach people the things that you couldn't learn anywhere else because nobody else was teaching it. Now, when I say this, other people who go to these schools say, yeah, we're learning. I'm like, okay, fine, good for you. But for the most part, as far as I knew, nobody's really talking about the business of creativity. And it's almost kind of like taboo to talk about money and negotiations, and I'm some kind of, charlatan. I'm some kind of blasphemer talking about money and design and the two. You know, it's okay for us to talk about it. So that's what we kind of, that's why we created this program on the future. But then as I learned, there's a lot of hunger out there for practical design stuff. And so now we're starting to rethink a little bit about what we want to teach. So we started out doing experiments with animation, teaching people design, typography. And so we'll see where this road leads us. But obviously, Matthew, myself, and some of the other creative directors here who've gone to Art Center to learn about motion design, we're more than capable of teaching you guys that kind of stuff, all right? So stay tuned for that. If you really want that stuff, you got to make it so noisy that we cannot ignore you. Otherwise, we're going to focus on what we think what you guys want, which is the business stuff.
Right. We have two other great questions.
Fire away, man.
What do you think about generative motion graphics?
Mm.
Also, follow-up question for me. What is that?
I knew you were going to ask that. Now, that's like, all you people that are like fine artists, they know that term. Oh, it's very generative art. It's basically something that generates more things. Okay, so some generative art, I'm assuming, is using some programs like Scriptographer or what's the other one? Processing,
yeah.
So those are the two programs I'm aware of. Scriptographer may not exist anymore, but processing is using code, and you give it a little bit of input, and it starts to make art for you, Ben, mm-hmm. which is really cool. Now, back in the day, there was this game, it's called Kix, Q-I-X.
Yep.
And it's like a weird sprite energy thing.
I
And you would draw a box and try to box that sucker in. And if you didn't complete your box, it would shock you and you would die. Whoa. But it's like this weird thing, like of energy, right? If you think about some of those screensavers that are really cool, that's generative. It's using code to generate patterns and fractals.
I see.
And it's really cool.
It's like that office clip where it almost gets to the corner every time, but it bounces at the left.
Whatever, Ben.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, not really, but yeah. So some of the designers who are very savvy with code wind up using processing to generate artwork. And here's how my brother explained this to me. Now, you guys don't know this, okay? But my brother is a computer science wizard. You know, he's in a couple of different startups and has exited out of two of them. And he's like, do you know what PostScript is? I'm like, yeah, it's Adobe PostScript, right? And he's like, dude, do you know what it is, you idiot? Okay, you know what PostScript is? PostScript is a mathematical language to describe an image on the screen. So he says you can open up your Adobe Illustrator file in like text edit and look at what it says. It'll That's say crazy. Start point here, draw here. It talks to you. So I remember a while back when coding art and people over at MIT, you know, they were doing this. They would take a logo and then they would bring in the important information into a piece of software, either hand code or use a off-the-shelf piece of software. And say, make these points in the logo travel through time, bend, scale, change the color, and do this. Now, you can't do that in any other program or any other plugin that I'm aware of. And they would produce amazing animation, and it was happening in real time. So we type the code and you would see it. Just you don't have that same kind of finesse, like the ease in, the ease out. So they would do that and they would generate some really beautiful imagery. And it kind of goes on autopilot. You know, it runs and it does its thing. And then they output frames from that. And then an editor would take that in and composite and do other kinds of things. So generative art like that, if I'm understanding it correctly, has a place. It's really good. Some of our friends over at Murata/Motion Theory were big into processing. And they were creating like very data and science-driven imagery that was really cool. And that's how you would do that. That's gotcha. Generative art. What's the second question?
All right, second question. Do you have advice for someone who needs to produce a showreel of work in which all the projects are totally different? Can you merge them together to make a gripping showreel without it looking bad? That comes from Miss Nichols.
Miss Nichols. Miss Nichols. Where? What platform did that come from?
YouTube.
YouTube. Miss Nichols, what's up? I think it's a woman, Miss Nichols?
Yes.
Matthew, I'm going to let you answer, then I'll give you my answer.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the whole goal of motion reels, just to be able to show the breadth of work that you could do and the concentration of your skill set. So I think if you were bouncing around at different studios, it's kind of a given that you have a pretty large skill set and that you work on various types of projects. When I think about any person that I'm trying to hire here, sometimes the people I bring in are highly specialized and they just do one thing, you know, like maybe they're just good at making FX for fireworks, right? Like that's just the one thing they do, and I have a tiny little piece that I need them to do in a larger spot. I'll bring them in for that thing because that's all I see on their reel. Then there's other people that I bring in all the time because they're just very strong generalists. Generalists meaning that they can work on anything. You know, they could work on 2D character animated spots all the way up to high-end realistic looking 3D things, and they always show like that broad range of stuff on their reel. So I think it's important, depending on how you market yourself, as to what you want to do and how that reflects in your reel. So it can be done, and I think it has to be done if you want to attract a really wide market.
All right, pick me, coach, pick me, I want in. Okay. What you're talking about is cutting a montage, right? So I think Matthew gave you some kind of broader perspective as to what you're supposed to do. The whole point of cutting a montage is it's supposed to be lots of different kinds of work. So what you're looking for are patterns. So now we're getting into like editing theory, okay? We've cut many montages, as you can imagine, over the 20 plus years of cutting reels. What you do is you group things that are kind of similar. So you can group things by color, by subject matter, by shape, by whatever else you can think of. So you can group a lot of the red things together. If you have a lot of camera moves in some of the pieces, you may group those together. And you're just looking to create little sequences that feel good together. For example, in one shot, if you have somebody coming towards camera and they put the hand over the camera and it blacks it out, and another shot, you have something going out of darkness into lightness, you can bridge those two shots together. And you're just looking to create these little moments, okay? So you edit these things together to music and you start to create little groupings of three or four pieces, and you rearrange them in order until they start to feel good. And some of them you have to speed up because the pacing is off, and some of them you have to kind of either slow down, like freezing it, and you can do those kinds of things. Another trick that you can do to unify all your different pieces, and some people are going to freak out when I say this, you can bring all the pieces, assemble in a timeline, in a sequential order, and bring a track in, a musical track, that's got a lot of breaks to it, like different beats and sounds. You can use, what is that plugin to extract the keyframes and the volume and all that kind of stuff, Matthew? There's a plugin for that.
Yeah, I don't know it off of the
yeah,
top of
we're
my
two
head.
Old bastards, yeah. So we're a little rusty on all the tools that you guys all know. But there is an audio plugin that you can extract the data from. And what you can do is you can map the values of noise or sound, the decibel level, to the sequence and retime it. So when you drop in, what is that? Not a drum and bass. What?
Dubstep?
Dubstep. I can't even remember dubstep, dude. Some kind of dubstep track.
Dubstep is just really slow drum and bass.
Oh, is it really?
Pretty much. That's the way that somebody explained it to me when it first came out. And I was right. Like, okay, that makes sense. Because drum and bass was that when we
you
were
know, I was in trance and trip hop and drum and bass. Right. And I stopped paying attention to all the different subgenres, right? It's like a genre within a genre. So what you can do then is you can use those keyframes to automatically scrub and freeze the timeline. So that inherently makes all the visuals kind of tied together, right? So when it does that wah, 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 that kind of sound, you know, mm-hmm. It would rewind the frame two or three frames. And then when it drops back in, it would skip it back to normal time. And so that's the way you use math to do the editing once you figure out the sequence. You know what I'm talking about? You ever seen that?
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You give me that look, right? I don't know.
No, because I heard your sound effects. You learned a little something from Trung Bao. So you're trying
to
use it right now.
No, you're mocking me.
I know you're practicing that in the shower, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, let everybody in on the inside joke. Who's Trung Bao?
Trung Bao is the latest person on our podcast, which you guys do need to check out. And please, please check it out, guys. We need you to check it out. We need you to give us a review and write something. Give us feedback. We really need it. It helps us with the rankings. And if you don't do it, we're going to stop making the podcast because it's a lot of work. But we have so many really super cool people we've talked to and still have yet to talk to. And if you don't do it, if you don't like it, I'm going to throw myself off a bridge, all right? That's it. Okay. Is that the best questions?
Or? Yeah. Are we doing Omer?
Omer, we can go back to Omer, but I've invited David
okay. On
screen, so we're going to bring David up. So I think that's how we're going to have to do this, Ben.
Hey, what's up, David?
Okay, and here's the deal. We'll do one, and we'll transition to YouTube, Facebook, and all that stuff, so we have time to allow each person to come on screen. David, where are you calling from again?
From Brisbane, Australia.
I said he was from Australia, and it's nice and sunny there or something like that, right?
Yeah, it's pretty sunny.
It's pretty hot too, right?
Good to be talking to you, Chris.
Good to be talking to you. You got a full-on killer headset? What brand is that?
Yeah, I had to borrow it from a mate, actually.
You shouldn't tell anybody that. You're like, dude, I rock the best gear. That's how I roll. Okay, so it seems like you've been in some kind of class here. You went to the design boot camp, is that right?
Yeah, the School of Motion.
School of Motion. Joey will be very happy to hear that plug. All right, School of Motion, and here's your storyboard. It would help if I shared it. And it's right.
Boom. And just for some context, I've been hanging out in the Futur group for 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
So I've really been enjoying it. Thanks a lot, Chris.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Is your time coming to an end with us soon or no?
Yes, it's ended a couple of days ago, I think. So.
Oh, okay, so I need to boot you out?
Oh, I've already been booted out, I think.
Oh, you've already been booted out. Oh, good job, Aaron. All right, just so you guys know, Dave did exactly what he's supposed to do. He tuned in during our Black Friday special, and he bought a product. And he bought the lowest priced product, if I remember this correctly. He bought 1 month of membership, and he won 3 months of membership. And so he did it like a boss, right?
That's
right. All right. Okay, so here we are. We're fast friends from the internet. And you want me to look at your frames, right?
Yeah, sure.
No, I mean, that's what you asked, isn't it?
Yeah, well, like, honestly, I'm getting into more 3D work now, but that's the best work I have on my portfolio, so.
Okay, well.
I think that would be great.
All right, I want to do a change of pace here, because, let me zoom in on this. a change of pace because we've been reviewing a lot of animation work, and my throat's dying here. I had a tour group here earlier today from Cal Poly for 2 hours, so I'm almost all talked out. All right, so here are your frames. I'm assuming you're reading left to right, top to bottom, right?
Okay.
What's that?
Are you on davidnewgang.com?
Oh, no. Okay.
Looking at the wrong portfolio.
I don't know how I clicked on that. Oh, here you are.
Okay.
Yeah. You have the coolest name, Uber Gang. Like two cool words together. Yeah, Uber Gang. All right. Which one do you want me to look at?
Take your pick.
No, that's not how this works.
You always take your pick on other people's ones.
You know what that's like?
One, that blue one's popping
you know
out
what?
At me.
All right, hold on. That's like saying, like, well, the other kids are doing it. All right, the blue one?
Go for the top left. Go for the top left.
Premium beat boards?
Yeah, because that was my last one.
Okay.
So they gave me all the... Well, I got all the illustrations from Shutterstock.
Okay. Now, while... You got all the illustrations from Shutterstock?
Yep.
Okay, all right. I'm just making sure I heard you right. So while I scan these things, tell us a little bit about the project.
Sure. So they gave us a voiceover. It's 15 seconds. And the idea is just to promote Premium Beat and their how easy their online service is to use.
Okay. All right. So you're taking elements and just composing them to tell a story, right?
Yep.
Okay. So I see a couple of transitions here. All right. I'm going to just go at this, all right? Is that okay?
Yep, go ahead.
Right, you ready?
I'm ready.
Make sure you got your boxing gloves on, because here we go. Okay, so one thing that I'm going to tell you to do, you guys, all you designers out there, it's a rule. It's not because I'm Asian, but squint your eyes and look at the work. When you crush down the values in your eyes, you're going to see things getting really muddy. So there's a couple of frames there. Four frames in, this guy's strumming the guitar. I close my eyes. And I'm not sure what I'm seeing because all the values, the color of his shirt, to the whatever the truss work behind him and the grays, they're all blending together. So as a director and as a designer, you need to control the values so that my eye can figure out what's going on. Okay. Whenever I teach a sequential design class, I always say the first thing you do is read the frame. If the frame is confusing, I cannot read it. So you solve. Confusion through clarity of design and being very intentional. All right, so that's the first thing. And if there's not enough stuff going on, you need to create drama. So we're always battling between drama and clarity. And those are two very important concepts to understand in doing any kind of design, whether it's still frame or a sequence like this. So if I'm reading this, I'm going to read this like a normal person. First frame, I see a star. I don't even know how I did that, but I just went full screen.
Yep. Yeah, all right. Would have no idea what that is.
Okay, so it's a star, and I don't know. So usually, the first frame is what you would consider your establishing shot. It's usually a wide frame. If you look at lots of movies, they basically start really wide, and they get closer and closer and closer until it becomes a series of close-ups. So think about the classic Western, where you'll see the landscape, you know, and some cacti or something, and then in the distance you see a man on a horse, but you can barely make out the scene, but you now know you're in the desert and there's a mountain range in the back. Then you punch in closer and closer and closer until eventually by the fifth or sixth shot, you now see that man is Clint Eastwood and he's squinting, right? And he's got some crow's feet around his eyes and he looks like a tough guy. He's got a poncho over him or something like that. So here, the first frame, I don't know what I'm looking at, so I'm a little confused. Then I realize we pull back and we're inside the drum kit, I think. I see that. And some element of composition here is to have what I would call small, medium, and large. What I mean is have something really big, have something really small, and something in the middle. It creates a lot of depth. When everything exists on a single plane, it gets very flat, which is what's happening here.
Yep.
Okay? And there's a Pixar PDF, and one of the rules at Pixar is don't have people walk on a tightrope. Look at frame 3. Those are people living and walking on a tightrope. Okay? There's a whole stage here. You can move the guitarist up front and shoot through his arm.
I could have had I was going to have seats in the foreground, so like you're sitting in the audience.
Yeah, but you don't even have to add people. Having people would be great. Like with, whose work was that, the first, the other guy with the beach scene?
I forget his name.
Not John. Well,
yeah.
You know, he had elements to frame it, and you can use that. But if this were, what's his name? Ben.
Ben.
Well, of course, Ben would remember
Buchanan.
Ben. If you just made the guitarist move him forward, and instead of having a line for the stage, make it a plane, right? That would look a lot better. The drummer's usually in the back. I don't know why, but they're always in the back.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so then you can design this frame, okay? And then we have this guy, okay, he's doing his thing with the guitar in frame five there. And somebody's yelling. Okay. Who is this person
Can I just say, this would make a lot more sense with the voiceover, which is, I left that at the end of the project. So if you scroll all the way to the bottom, I have the timing block out.
Okay.
So we're actually timed it with the voiceover.
Okay.
That might make a bit more sense.
It would make more sense, except for I'm not going to critique you on your storyboard.
Yeah.
So now I see a guy with a mustache, but we've not established anybody with a mustache so far. I don't know if this is a security guy, if it's a guy in the audience. I don't know if we're in another country now. So there's some issues there, okay? So that's why it's important. Like, which guy is it that has a mustache?
Yeah, you couldn't even see from there.
It's a drummer, right? No. The drummer has, like, a handlebar mustache.
It's the middle guy, the guitarist.
Oh, the guitarist. Okay, so the bassist is in front. Okay, see, so it's like, I'm a little confused. And so after a little while, if you're just a normal person, look at this, David, you're going to say, I'm confused, I'm bored, I'm moving on.
Yeah.
Okay, so this can all be solved through design. Okay? Staging, lighting, color, and contrast help me to read the story. So you have a couple of moves here where it swipes over and then it reveals what? He's on the on a wallpaper or there's a video going on. They swipe left. They hit play, swipe, swipe. Okay. The other thing that you want to do is vary the camera angles and the backgrounds. Now, when I see graphic pieces, I like to see them just graphic. And then when there are pieces that are very cinematic, I like that too. This is kind of a weird middle ground. And it's the same problem that I think, was it Josh? I forget anybody's name. Somebody, the one with Busta Rhymes. Too much motion blur. You know, a lot of people use duplicate layers to show the direction of the motion. I think that's one way to do it. I think the better way to do it is to use squash and stretch and use exaggerated lines or by design.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I'm not a big fan of like blurry things to show what direction the camera is traveling or what direction the hand's moving. So I'm gonna pretend like you wanna be a killer storyboard artist, designer, and just focus on these things. Focus, maybe push in tight on the fingernail as it swipes, then pull back out to the wide shot and give me some more variety there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, since you said at the head of this that you're like actually more into animation now, you know, that I understand. Somebody else will do the storyboards and you'll bring it to life.
Yeah, I've actually been getting into 3D modeling a lot recently.
Okay.
It's just, yeah, I remember you saying on the Facebook group, oh, don't do that, it's a waste of time.
yeah, don't do that. it's a tough racket to be in, man.
I enjoy it, so.
Okay. All right. I'm getting a little tired. It is, now we're almost an hour and a half into this. I'm going to sign out with you. Thanks for jumping on, and it was nice to have you in the group while it lasted. Okay?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Chris.
All right, man, take care.
See ya.
Bye. Woo, I'm tired, dude. I'm gonna close that.
You got enough in you to answer a question?
Yeah, answering questions is easy when I have to pilot and do all these things.
Definitely. So Joe Schmo.
Joe Schmo. Real name Joe Schmo.
Real name. No AKA there. He says, Chris, can you talk about overtime? And if it's a good idea.
Overtime.
Yeah. If it's a good idea to pay employees for the overtime, or is it expected of them to just do overtime without being paid because it's a yearly salary? Kind of a weird question for a motion critique, but he's asked a couple times, so he really wants to know.
Okay, Joe Schmo. Matthew, answer first. You got 10 seconds on the clock. Go ahead.
I think overtime as a freelancer is one thing. When I was working as a freelancer, I charged overtime just because I knew I was pretty good with my hours. I was very responsible about the hours that I put into work. so that I know if I were exceeding, you know, 8 or 10 hours, that I would be charging overtime. I think as staff, it's a little bit different. Regardless if you're staff or freelance, knowing that you're brought in to do a very specific task, regardless if you do that in 2 hours or if you do it in 10, I think the idea is that it gets done. And that depends on a lot of things. That depends on the difficulty of the task being asked of you versus your skill level and how fast you can do it. So if you're low skilled, of course it's gonna take you more hours, and I think that's just kind of the name of the game. And as you become more and more skilled, it's gonna take you less hours. So you become more valuable as a designer, as an animator, versus the person who's highly skilled, they could do it super quick. If they finish it in 2 hours, do I pay them less money? I know Chris has a very specific viewpoint on all of this, but hopefully that helped.
I'll throw something in there.
Overtime, anybody here can answer, so Ben, you go.
Yep. I mean, you gotta follow the legal requirements. Do that, or you'll get hemmed up. So that's my advice.
Okay.
Chris's turn.
That was really succinct.
Yeah.
Overtime, I hate overtime. It's a double-edged sword. And overtime is a good tool for both the employer and the employee when the workload is such that the people that are tasked to do their job can't do it in a reasonable amount of time. Okay? And there are some jobs where that just has to be. And you say very willingly and openly to everybody, guys, we have some killer deadlines to hit. I've gotten money from the client, so we're going to run this project. We're going to need to run it overtime. We're going to need to run into the weekends. If you guys are sport enough, we'll pay you and we'll treat you fairly, and that's the way it's going to be. But that needs to be a discussion that happens up front. And that's as simple as that. Where I don't like overtime is, you know, I don't micromanage people. I give them a task to do, and I give them what I think can be done within a day. Then I even ask them, can you do this today? And they say yes. So when they hang out till like 10 o'clock, and I'm not expecting to get a bill, because maybe half the time they're on Facebook, which happens a lot here. The other half of the time, they're like looking at a movie while half focusing. So the counter to this is, if you make me watch your time, then don't get upset when I stand behind you and look at what you're doing. I don't like that kind of oppressive environment. I'd rather hire people who want to work like adults and be treated like one. We give people enough work that they can reasonably do in 8 hours amount of time. We do not work the weekends, we do not work holidays, and we haven't done so in a really, really long time. There is, every once in a while, an exception. Typically, it happens right around delivery. Around delivery, we'll work a little bit longer, but we've gotten really good at managing projects, managing client expectations, so that we don't have to sit there and grind it out to 4 in the morning. I'm not saying it was always this way. So if some of you old timers are watching this now or later, it's like, back in my day, that didn't happen. And that's true, it didn't happen. We would literally see the sunrise together, and it's usually right with my interns. It was horrible. And the interns were so slow, and we had deadlines, and they're just so slow. And I would sit there and work with them. And back then I looked at it like, yay, it's like quality bonding time. Later on, I'm like, this is stupid. I'd rather be home in my bed and hang out with my kids. This is dumb. We need to change things. We need to hire more qualified interns. We need to give them tools and to teach them how to manage the time better and tell us that's beyond my skill level. And to be okay hearing that, to say, you know what? I get it. That's going to take you 4 times as long. Okay, we'll have to move some things around, but we can make this work. Okay? And so that's the overtime thing. Guys, most of you guys want overtime because the companies you work for abuse you, take you for granted, give you too much work, don't give you any room to push back, and don't really care. For those instances, overtime, that's all fine. All right, let's do another question, and then we're going to bring on Omer, and we're ended on Omer.
Excellent. So,
wait, hold on. Did I invite the right guy? Go ahead.
So what?
No, go ahead. I messed up.
Okay. There's two topics that are being discussed in the YouTube chat.
Okay.
The first being unpaid internships, pros and cons. And the second is we're getting a lot of demand to go through a real client experience here at Blind and see us kind of work day to day and do a whole series about that. So you pick which one you want to address.
Okay. Sorry, I was dealing with some technical stuff. A real client project requires a willing client to allow us to share. All right, you guys? You do realize something. There is both an explicit and an implicit thing where they trust you to do the work, and sometimes the work cannot be seen before it's ready to go live, and sometimes that could be years. Mm-hmm. We've worked on projects that nobody's ever seen except for our client. And you have to respect that. The number one thing that you're selling is trust. The second thing you're selling is assurance, and they're kind of closely tied together. You guys abuse the trust, you lose the client, and forget about your business. So we can never betray that, okay? Even if the client says, you know what, guys, we know it's okay to show that, but we don't want people to see it, we'll take it down. We gotta do right by our client. So maybe somebody's watching this at some point, they're like, hey, pick me. I'll be the client. I live a very open and transparent life. Nothing we do is a secret. Actually, I'll benefit from all the discussion and the exposure that we're getting through your channel. I mean, we're at 78,000 subscribers right now, thanks to you guys, and growing, about 300 to 400 every single day. So this channel is getting bigger and more powerful and more popular. So at some point, people will hire blind to do work just because of the media exposure they get for free. Now, Oli's is the exception. Now, Oli's, they're not doing anything like top secret software. It's a great experience. And so I asked the operating the manager if I can show the work. He's like, yeah, go ahead. So we've shown that process, and you guys have seen behind the scenes prior to the site even going live. That's pretty cool. That's a really cool client, all right? So you guys, if there are more clients out there that are willing to do that, then we'll do it. But we are documenting the process. We just can't show it to you until the clients say it's okay. One such thing is the 99 cent store project, which we'll be sharing with you guys pretty soon. What's the other question?
Unpaid internships, pros and cons. How do you feel about it?
Unpaid interns?
Mm-hmm.
How do I feel about them?
Yeah, we're having a conversation here, and people are like, it's barely legal. You know, is it worth it?
Yeah, you guys. Listen to me. If you want to do it and they want to do it with you, it's freaking legal. You're two adults, do it. Oh, we're talking about work.
Yeah.
You guys, come on. Some of you guys are not worth, I'm just sorry, I'm gonna say it. Some of you guys are not even worth the machine that you're occupying. And I'll tell you what I mean. Because a company has limited space, a desktop, a computer, and they need to put human beings in front of it that can move the game forward, right? We gotta move the chain, if you will. And some of you guys are so slow and need so much help. At some point, Matthew and I look at each other like, this is not worth it. They're not only just taking up the computer, but we're also paying them. Now, we do not personally do unpaid internships, but I'm not saying that there's a hard and fast rule. The way we do it, the way we manage it is this, is if you're good enough to work for us, then we should pay you something. What we do is we pay our interns a flat rate of $10 an hour for an 8-hour day for 40 hours a week. It's a full-time internship, so that means you know you're gonna get $500. Is it 500? 80 times five, $400 every single week. And if there's a holiday, we still pay you. So we try to treat you like a full-time temporary employee kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I know Starbucks pays you more, but they're not gonna teach you how to do what we do. So if you think about it, Matthew, myself, Greg, and Ben are gonna teach you more than what you're getting paid. So you have to think about that. Running joke, even with our staff here, Ben, is am I paying you today or are you paying me? Because every day I feel like I'm giving you more than you're giving me. Okay, so think about that. So don't go into an internship opportunity and work for free for a job that goes nowhere for people who will never speak to you and just have you running errands. I would not do that. You have to think about what you're getting out of it. And the easiest way to think about this is you used to pay somebody and maybe still are paying somebody, a school, a lot of money so they can teach you. So now you're going to get all like uptight because somebody else is going to teach you and you want them to pay you on top of that. Why don't you think about that? All right, last person, Omer. Hello, caller. Where are you calling from, Omer? Omer, you're on screen, but you're on chat. You're from LA. This is going to be strange, Omer. You're invited on the screen and you can't speak and there's no camera.
Dude, he's been hitting you up on YouTube like 80 times. Where are you, Omer?
He's in LA.
He said, I'm on chat from LA.
My mic is sucking. Well, it sucks so bad I can't even hear you. That's beyond suck, dude.
Is it broken?
People, I told you guys. Get your camera, get your makeup on, get the hair done, and get your mic working.
We're going to have to start auditioning.
No kidding.
Jeez.
My God. Okay, so Omer... this is going to be the last time I review somebody's work who's not ready to do the thing, okay? So, Omer, this is, where are you? There you are. There's your work. This is my showreel. It's got some motion UI work. What do you think of the overall production, timing, and music? Let me know what you think. All right. Here it is. Let me get the volume going. Oh, I need to share this. I think it's this one. All right. So let's play this. Let's turn on the volume. And let's make it go big, like that. If it breaks, Ben, it's your fault.
I accept this.
To be fair, I'm gonna stop this at 1 minute in because it's like almost 2 minutes long. All right, I'm gonna scrub this at the beginning. Let's just show real, okay. All right, Omar wants to know about timing and that kind of stuff. What, you know, that kind of. So the first problem I have with this, Matthew, let me see if it does it or not before I open my mouth. Yeah, Omar, dude, if I'm looking at your reel and you're looking for work for me, I'm confused. I don't know what you do. Usually people start off by saying, I'm a user interface animator, or I'm a blah, blah, blah. I have no idea what you do, okay? Be very, very clear, because I have a very short window to figure out what you do, and then I'm gone. Now, with David Ubergang, with David, I looked at his work, and I was like, I don't know what I'm looking at, because of the design of the frames. You, Omar, have a similar thing. It's like, I don't know what you do. Why don't you just tell me what you do at the beginning? So I know what to look for. So it's not after a while, I'm like, dude, what does he do? Does he do After Effects, compositing? Did he do the 3D logo? Oh, he's a game programmer, right? I don't know what you do. And you don't tell me in the beginning, I don't know what to look for.
Maybe he's like a Twitch guy, I don't know.
We just don't know. So I think you're a user interface designer. That's what it said on the question, I believe. Mm-hmm. Let me see here. Omar. Yeah, the UI work. So just call yourself a user interface designer, user interface animator, something like that. Mm-hmm. Just so we know. And so here's what I would do. I would show this and stop it and hide the video part and just focus on the screen. Blow up into it. Zoom in. Show me what you got. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah, that was going to be my biggest critique is like I don't know what part of this he did because I see a lot of running gameplay footage. So what part of it did you do? And there's a lot of ways to show off how you do the UI. And I think our friends over at Cantina, they do all UI for movies, for a lot of like Marvel films and stuff. And the way that they do their reels is they'll show the shot in context and then they'll do a follow-up shot of just the UI by itself, floating by itself. So you can appreciate the design and the animation for that. For this one, it's just all in context and there's a bunch of logos for I'm assuming, companies that you worked at. I don't know if you animated those things. It's really hard to tell. So I think just showing the work on its own or some kind of shot breakdown or something would help give us some context as to how to evaluate it.
Yeah. Believe me, I know what the dilemma here is here, Omar, is that we think, oh, it's not very sexy or they don't, oh, once they recognize the title, give me some credibility to validate me. And yeah, that's true. So show a little bit of it and then erase all that parts and focus in on the parts that you're designing. Maybe even draw a highlight over it. Just and you know, this is what I designed. Freeze frame it, user interface design, then play it back, but lose the picture because it's going to help you. Now, it may be a situation where he designed the interface and animated it, but you can't strip it out of the background somehow because it's part of code.
Right.
There might be that issue. I don't know what that issues there are, but in most cases, if you animated the user interface, you should be able to reproduce that or strip away the other elements. Okay.
Right.
The other thing here is. Matthew said it spot on. Now I think you're trying to do animated logos or something, and I'm confused, right? and my attention span is very short. I've got about 20 seconds to decide if you're the right guy or girl for the job. And that's not a lot of time. Notice how a minute in, I'm like, it's already long. And then why are you showing me an arcade cabinet? It's not user interface, it's not animated logo. So there's an editor, and I went to this workshop, I forget the guy's name, but he said this. He says, people are looking for meaning and patterns, okay? So he's like, one shot will not show you a pattern. Two shots might, three shots will. I'm looking for a pattern. So you show me an interface, and then you show me an animated logo, I'm confused. I'm trying to draw meaning between these two things. And then let's just pretend like you show the arcade cabinet next, wherever it is. I lost it. There. I'm like, what is a user interface, an animated logo, and an arcade cabinet have to do with each other? And I'm confused.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm pretty good at recognizing patterns. This one I cannot figure out. So Omer, that's it in a nutshell. I hope that was helpful. I don't know if it was, but that's what you got. And next time, fix your mic, dude. All right, where am I? I'm gonna stop sharing my screen.
The guy doing the karate move at like 37 seconds was pretty awesome. Just saying.
I didn't even see it. All right, guys. I'm a little tired. Okay.
We are.
You know what happens? Okay, arcade cabinet is the branding I did. So now you do branding too. You're like the Swiss Army knife, dude. Come on, focus up. If you want to get work, if you want to be well known, do one thing, do it really well. Okay? You guys know who Ash Thorpe is? Ash Thorpe. He does the Collective Podcast, he does Learn Squared. People think about him, and he does a couple things really, really well. One, he used to do a lot of user interface stuff for movies like Ender's Game. I don't know what other movie he did, like maybe Iron Man. Whatever. He's known for doing some sick user interface animations and design. And then he does his own art projects, but that's totally different. So get known for one thing. Focus on that. All right? Yes, he knows Ash. Ash is awesome. See, you know Ash because he does one thing. He does it really, really well. All right? Spencer is signing off here. Guys, good to see you. You guys know how this format works now. I don't know what the next theme or subject that we're going to be talking about, but the key is to register. The key is then to post your question. Make it a darn good question. Make the link really clear so people have a chance to vote it up and down. The earlier you do that, the better off you are, okay? If you join late and you add your question late, you got zero votes. Look at all those zero votes. Oh, my God. And I don't have time. And I'm out of energy.
And this is for my people on YouTube. The best thing that you can do is to go to the website, thefutur.com, sign up for our newsletter, and keep an eye on your inbox. We send announcements for these things a week ahead of time and ask for work. So you guys that have submitted work in the comments here, I really appreciate that, but you missed the boat a little bit. So sign up for the email newsletter there.
Sign up for the email newsletter, like our Facebook page, and we will let you know of upcoming events. Now, I know Ben is working on a master calendar. We're trying to work on this. So we're trying to like give this a little bit more shape and structure. So you'll know in March, we're gonna be doing something in July. So you know it's gonna be a live event, if it's ticketed or not, if it's free. We got a cool lettering workshop that's coming up with one of my former professors, Niels Lindstrom. He's gonna be here to teach us how to letter. It's gonna be an all-day event. Hit me up on the internet if you want more information on it. I don't have all the details yet, but it's going to be happening, I think, in not this coming Monday, but the following Monday, like in March. Like like 2 weeks from now, we're going to have this. Ah, I'm all jacked up!
You can find out with our email newsletter. Yeah,
all right, guys, here's the deal. I'm going to ask you one more time, okay? One more time. Please, please check out the Futur podcast on iTunes, on Stitcher, on Google Play. It's on a slightly different address, so all your old links to it don't work anymore. And we have a brand new sponsor that I'm really proud of having. They provide a product that I love personally. It's called HelloFresh.com. And if you guys go there and you check out, use the code FUTUR, F-U-T-U-R. You'll save $35 off your first meal. It's HelloFresh.com. They'll send you a little box. It's meals planned for like two or three people, or you're in a whole family. You can pick the kind of food you want. It's pretty awesome. Support us, support our sponsors so that we can keep doing this for the great price of free. This is how this happens, all right, guys? Thanks for tuning in. And on behalf of Matt and Ben Burns and myself, I wish you a great weekend. Take care, guys.
Bye-bye.
See you, everybody.
Thank you.
See ya. See you, internet. Take care, man.